This was a study that was focused on understanding speech intelligibility and actually sources of variability in speech intelligibility in children who have cerebral palsy. And so one of the things about speech intelligibility is that historically in the study of speech intelligibility, we have focused on understanding what is wrong with the individual speaker. So we study acoustic characteristics of speech, we characterize articulation errors, voice errors, nasality, respiratory kinds of problems. And of course the disorder does emerge from the problems that the speaker experiences that are due to a neurological insult or situation. But there's another part to that equation that's equally as important, and that is what the listener does with that information. And so what we've been looking at and thinking about for a number of years now is how the listener's perception of the speech signal actually contributes to the speaker's understandability. And as it turns out, there are some listeners who are very good at making sense of a very distorted speech signal, and other listeners who are not so good, and there's a lot of variability among individuals. So this study was really about looking at, initially, how variable are people, and how many listeners should we have in order to understand intelligibility in a child with cerebral palsy or an adult with, you know, dysarthria or any sort of speech disorder? What does it take to capture that range of variability in the listener? And so what we did was we had five listeners, different people, for each child in the study. We had 24 children who had cerebral palsy and a confirmed diagnosis of dysarthria, and we had 20 age-matched, typically developing children. So these are kids that are about 5.5 years of age. And we had five different listeners per child come in, and they heard the children producing utterances that were 1 to 4 words in length, and they transcribe what they hear the children say. And they orthographically transcribe. No phonetics, no nothing. They listen and they type into the computer, this is what I thought the person said. And then we analyze that for whether or not what the listeners typed in matched what the child actually said. And we looked at each individual listener and we tried to characterize how much variability, given the same kid, is there within these five different listeners per child. And the other piece of that is that each individual listener has some variability within him or herself. So I might hear something different the second time I hear it than the first time I hear it. And we were trying to understand what's the impact of just within-person variability and between-person variability on speech intelligibility. And so we found a couple of interesting things there. One thing we found is that there's a lot of variability within listeners. In fact, there's more variability within listeners than there is between listeners. But that can be accounted for by variables related to the nature of the words and sentences that the children were producing. And so people were actually quite consistent from time one to time two in hearing the same utterance. They made the same sorts of mistakes. They got the same things right from time one to time two. But there's a huge range of variability associated with what those words and sentences were for an individual listener. There were also lots of differences between listeners as well, and that turned out to be the most important aspect of the work, is the between listener variability. It was a little bit less predictable in some sense. And so, and it accounted for a pretty significant chunk of the variance in intelligibility scores. So it turns out what the listener brings to the table accounts for the typically developing children, about 27% of the variance in intelligibility, which is pretty big. And it accounts for less of the variability in the children with dysarthria, which is also interesting, but speaks to that issue, going back to where we started in the beginning, of how the impairment that the speaker brings to the table might impact what the listener is able to hear. So it really is a combination of that disorder piece and the listener's perceptual abilities and ability to make sense of the speech signal that contributes to speech intelligibility. The other piece to this work that we looked at was how well intelligibility scores might differentiate between typically developing children and children with cerebral palsy. And it kind of seems like a no-brainer in some ways that the speech intelligibility scores should be very clearly different between these two groups of kids. But one of the challenges that we see in children is that when you're young, dysarthric speech errors actually overlap to a great extent with typical developmental speech errors. So we know there's a lot of variability in typically developing children in that some kids just are not as intelligible as other kids. And we don't know when children should become fully intelligible and actually what that growth curve should look like for typical children. And that's an area of investigation that my group is beginning to look really closely at right now. But in this study, what we really wanted to see was what is a cut point? For five-year-old kids, where would be the place that we could say definitively, if you are at this level, you are typical, or if you are above this level, you are not typical? And essentially what we found that is that there's a cut at about 75% intelligibility. For the children who had cerebral palsy and dysarthria, if they had intelligibility scores below 75%, they definitely, it was very clear, those children fell into the dysarthric category. Children who had scores above 85% were almost always typically developing, with a few very minimal exceptions to that. And this range between 75 and 85% intelligible was what we call the gray area, where there were some dysarthric kids in there and there were also some typical kids in there. So what this says is that if we have a kid who's between 75 and 85% intelligible, we really need to look very carefully at them and not make assumptions that they're typically developing, but do a full speech and language assessment to try to determine if there might be something else going on. Now, these were just dysarthric kids, but there are certainly implications and a need for future research looking at children who may have cleft palate speech, deaf speech, children who have phonological articulatory kinds of errors. Definitely these findings may have some implications for those populations as well. These results were pretty preliminary. It was a small group of children, and all of our typically developing children were probably on the higher end of typically developing. So this is a preliminary finding, and we need more research with larger numbers of children who are typically developing in particular, as well as children who have dysarthria and work on children with other sorts of speech disorders to start to really determine if this 75% is really solid and really valid. So right now, what we're really focusing in on is looking at larger scale study of typically developing children for speech intelligibility, because I'm very enthusiastic about this idea of using intelligibility measures to differentiate children who have dysarthria from children who don't, and particularly these gray kids who may be the low level typical kids and the high level dysarthric kids, and figuring out what will tell us where those children fall in terms of whether they're typical or not. So our group is really shifting our focus a little bit, or actually expanding our focus, to include the study of a large number of typically developing children and to develop these growth curves for speech intelligibility and speech rate to differentiate between typical and atypical children between the ages of 3 and 7. So getting these young kids to try to develop clinically relevant measures and tools that tell us something about function that we can use for identifying children and moving forward with intervention.